Hey guys, today's episode is with Diane Forster. Diane is an award-winning inventor, a best-selling author, TEDx speaker, TV host, podcaster, intentional living expert, and reinvention specialist. She works with clients privately on helping them clear away mindset blocks and limiting beliefs that can block them from reaching their full potential in business, life, and relationships. She's the CEO and founder of I Have Today and the best-selling author of I Have Today, Find Your Passion, Purpose, and Smile. Finally. Diane's career began in advertising and TV sales, including Disney and ABC. She's an inventor of the Spifter. It's a fun kitchen tool that won an innovation award at the International Houseware Show in Chicago. She's going to fill you in on that in the episode. Really cool little story of manifestation and believing in yourself. And you know, this episode starts out really tender. Diane gets really vulnerable about the lowest of lows in her life and how she was able to find her passion and her purpose from that point. And I know so many of you, including myself, can relate to that. So really powerful episode. It's going to give you a lot of food for thought on how your struggles can become your strengths. And she's just so inspiring in what she's done with her life. It was just such a delight to have Diane on the show. So we'll go ahead and jump in. Here is Diane Forster.
Okay, guys, here I am with Diane Forster, and I'm so excited for you to be here with me. Thank you for taking time out today to join our audience and share a little bit.
My pleasure, Tara. So happy to be here with you.
Okay. So guys, if you're not watching on YouTube, Diane's got a sign behind her that says, I have today. And as I mentioned, her book is called I Have Today. Your coaching is I Have Today. And I love this. I was like, really thinking about that. I'm like, why did he choose that of all the things? When I hear it from the horse's mouth, why did you choose I Have Today?
Well, actually it chose me. When I went through my, I guess we're jumping right in. So let's jump right in. Yeah. You know, I had a suicide attempt in June of 2011 and experienced a God moment in the bathroom that night that really woke me up and set me out on a path and a quest the next day to change my life. And so when I started doing that work and really diving deep into personal development and self-help and starting to really have my spiritual awakening, and a lot of things started happening to me and for me, it fired up a lot of creativity, which I'm already a creative person. Like I already am an inventor, and I've always liked writing and poetry, but I started creating a lot and writing a lot and getting a lot of downloads from spirit, from the universe, from God, whatever you call it. But they just, the ideas and the creativity kept coming. Mm-hmm. And so I was writing a lot of stories and poetry. And one night in the middle of the night, I woke up with a poem in my head called I Have Today.
Wow.
And I wrote it down as fast as I could. And when I finished writing it, I looked down on it and I said, this is way more than a poem. This is a movement. Mm-hmm. And I could instantly see above my head, I Have Today, the network productions. And so it allowed me to connect the dots to what God told me in the bathroom the night of my suicide attempt, which was, you're not ending your life this way, Diane. You need to go get help so that you can tell your story and you can help others. Mm-hmm. And 2 years after that was when I wrote the poem, and I connected it back and I said, oh, okay, this is what God was talking about in the bathroom that night. So it just, that poem became my theme for life. And it really, those three words, I have today, say it all. It's truly all we have. And so, like I said, it really was given to me. It was gifted to me, that inspiration. And it's just been an amazing, amazing brand to build upon. I mean, it covers so much, so many things, but talk about getting you in the present moment and realizing how precious and valuable your life is, because all we have is today. Mm-hmm. Truly all we have is today. Right. It's a beautiful reminder and a wake up call to getting back to the present moment. So,
wow. Yeah. Okay. So many things to say, but first, thank you for sharing that so vulnerably, especially like right out of the gate. I'm like, oh, I've got so many chills. And I know there's so many people that can relate to that. Like that's their current situation, is their battle.
Yes.
daily or weekly or monthly or whatever, a lot, like more people than who probably talk about it, for sure, you mm-hmm. know. And
definitely.
And I love the gratitude that you have found on the flip side of that, on like the full gratitude that you have a today, because you almost didn't have today or any of the days, you know. So the gratitude that sets in. But I guess where my heart goes to is, what, you know, for people who might be going through that right now, you know, can you share some of your insights on what you learned and how to, you know, the, like the universe taught you, like you come help people. What did you learn that helped pull you out of that place, that dark hole that you were in, to come to this place I'm grateful for today?
Yeah. All right. Well, let me back it up a little, because I just kind of like blurted it out and it's like, wait, whoa, that, you know, there's some context to this story, obviously. But the little bit of my background is, you know, I was working in corporate America. I was working for Disney ABC. I was living in Chicago. I was married. I was raising my twins. I have a boy-girl twins, and had what looked like to the outside world this have it all life. Truly, I mean, the packaging of it looked really good. What was going on internally was very, very different. And you know, the relationship with my ex really became evident that there was a problem early on in the marriage. There was just a disconnect. We loved each other, but we weren't in love with each other. And we were in many ways like oil and water. And there were so many struggles in that relationship. And yet I fought so hard to make it work. I did not want to be another statistic, a divorce statistic. I wanted to make it work. I was just determined to do that. And we went in and out of therapy. And the thing is, nobody knew how unhappy I was, or we were. Let's just say we were, but let me focus on me, how unhappy I was. Very, very few people in my world knew this. I just kept it hidden. I just kept pretending that it would get better and things would get easier. And then some subsequent things happened. My mom ended up getting colon cancer and dying of cancer. I was having infertility issues at the same time that was going on. And then I ended up getting, you know, God bless me, and I got pregnant the month after my mother died, which was just a bitter sweet experience. But then life in our relationship, in our marriage, became all about the kids, which it happens to so many people, you know, everything was about that. And so my needs, my wants, my desires, the things that I deserved kept getting put further and further and further back there on the back burner. And I just got to the point where I just pretended that I didn't need them anymore, you know, that this is just the way it is. And I did a lot of when, then, and someday, or one day I'll change it. Just kept ignoring it. Well, you can't live like that indefinitely, because it just progressively kept getting worse. And it ultimately caused me to go in and have surgery and remove part of my colon, because the stress of my life was literally killing me. Yeah. And my mom died of colon cancer, and I was headed down that path. Yeah. And so the attempted suicide night, that night, was not anything that I had ever thought about before. I just hit a breaking moment. I just snapped, and it was a regular Saturday. We were running around with the kids to and from sporting events and practices and errands. We ended up going to some friend's house for a barbecue that night and having a great time. There were a bunch of families there. And when we got in the car to go home, the fighting started. And so when I got home, I snapped. I went up into the bathroom. I pulled out two full bottles of prescription pain medication from that colon surgery that I had sitting in a drawer that I couldn't take because they made me so sick. Mm. And I was there in that moment. And so that moment of me holding them, the pills got knocked out of my hand, like a karate chop to my arm. And that voice screamed and said what I said earlier: you're not ending your life this way. You need to go get help so that you can tell your story and you can help others. So that's, and then I took the command, I took the order right away, and I went into action the next day. So now back to your how do you come out of that and completely reinvent your life to be doing what I'm doing right now? It's definitely a process. It's day by day. It's knowing and trusting. It's getting to a place where you can really completely and unconditionally love yourself. That's what was missing for me all along. I didn't really love myself. I was seeking the fulfillment that I wanted from outside of me when it was in me all along. That's where it is for all of us. And we, you know, I wanted to blame my ex. There were things I could have blamed him for, and I wanted to blame this or that. And that's not where it was. And so I started really delving into personal development. I started going, you know, attending every event I could, watching every webinar and reading every book and listening to every podcast, and just got immersed in all of this and was healing in this very, very profound way. And so I had started a meditation practice. So I'd been doing that for months and months. I was journaling and writing like crazy. I was doing that. And again, immersed in all of this. While still raising my twins, while still working at ABC and having these other things, but every spare moment I had, I was in it. Mm-hmm. And so I woke up one morning, it was 2 months after my ex moved out. And after a brief pity party I had for myself, you know, why me, why this, you know, and, you know, all of that, that we go through, that we're entitled to go through. I woke up one morning and instead of doing my regular meditation, I was guided to do an I forgive you chant. Mm. And so I sat down on the couch and I closed my eyes and I chanted, I forgive you, I forgive you, I forgive you, I forgive you, I forgive you for 20 minutes.
Wow.
And Tara, it was the most beautiful, cathartic thing I had ever experienced up until that point in my life.
Wow.
And I was forgiving me. First and foremost, me.
Yep.
I was forgiving him. I was forgiving everyone of everything in my entire life that led me to that moment. It was like wiped everything out. Mm. So incredible. And then when I stood up, I'm sorry, I don't mean to interrupt. Let me just tell you, but when I stood up, you know, tears streaming down my face, like it was so incredibly powerful. I said, wait a minute, I did this. I'm the one that's responsible for the condition of my life. I was the enabler. I was the allower. You know, I didn't set healthy boundaries. And this isn't out there. This is me. And I am declaring right now that I am going to have an extraordinary life. And I'm going to do everything I can to get it. And it really shifted things in so many ways. But that was such a kick in my butt and really awakened me deeper than I was already becoming awakened. And then I just started making decisions from that place. I'm going to have an extraordinary life. I have an extraordinary life. And so for somebody out there who's feeling it, which I know there are, and I know the statistics, you know, there's 153 people who are going to commit suicide today. And the numbers are up, you know, plus 30%. They're skyrocketing since COVID. They're, you know, people with depression and anxiety, and it's worse and worse and worse. And people are feeling that strangle and that chokehold. Mm-hmm. And I know where you are and where you've been, and I feel for you. And you just have to know this is a moment. It's just a moment, and it's a feeling, and it will pass. Let it pass, you know, kind of breathe through it. There's other tips I have, but that's the first thing you need to know. This is just a moment. It's just a moment. And most of the stuff going on out there doesn't even matter. It's not even real. It's that world. And the only world that matters is this one, your world. Your world is the one that matters.
So what's really interesting to me about your story, and I can relate on so many levels, because I was also living the picture perfect life and married and four kids and had a total complete life transformation. But and rock bottom was my ticket there, you know, so I'm a huge fan of rock bottoms because they usually are shifting us into the life that we need to be living versus the life that we were living for everyone else.
Right.
But what I find really interesting about your story that I think is relatable to so many people is, you know, for example, I was just talking to a friend the other day who has had suicidal ideation her entire life, like since she was like 10 years old. Her stress is to want to exit the planet. And you know, for her, that's a lot of, that's a mental illness, I guess you could call it that way. Amygdala activity is really high. Her fear center, she's in hyper fight or flight mode. And what I find interesting about your journey though, is that this, and I can relate, this was led by you feeling completely trapped to the point of extreme fight or flight mode. Like maybe you didn't have mental illness that you had suicidal thoughts your entire life, but by living a life as in a shell of a human, of this is what people want me to be, this is what I have to do, this will make me loved, this will be enough, completely putting your soul on the back burner, it led you to that same place of that hyper fight or flight mode. Like I have no other way out of this. Like I'm stuck.
Right.
Are into this road, yeah, of what will people think, and I have to do life this way, that you just wanted to peace out. Like you were just like, I can't anymore, you know? And I think that's a lot of us. I did, when I went through my lowest of lows, I had done some things that I was really ashamed of. And I was like, I've never even told anybody this ever. This is my first time ever saying this out loud, but I was very tempted to just drive across the yellow lines. Like I just couldn't stop thinking about it. I was like, that would be so fast. Like that would be such an easy way to just make this all be over, you know? And again, I'm like you, I don't have depression. I don't have like the mental illness side of things, but purely from being so trapped, feeling so trapped with no way out was what led me there. And I love what you're saying. And I can relate is like, for people that are maybe in that boat, you know, showing the step-by-step of here's how we do. First, we settle in with our soul. We find some compassion. For me, the Ho'oponopono, which is similar to you, you know, like Ho'oponopono is that same, thank you, I love you, I forgive you, I'm sorry. And I mean, I did like an hour long sound healing with that and purged so much stuff. So I think that forgiveness and compassion is the first step. I really, really do.
Yes.
Until you get there, you're still in guilt. But then, you know, beyond that, could we dive a little more into some of these, you know, daily actions that you found that really pulled you out of that hole, and anything else you have to share too, your spiritual insights, tapping in, all of that?
Yes. I'm happy to do that. And again, let me just preface this before I answer this, because I was depressed, not clinically depressed, but here's the thing. And this is who I serve. This is the group of women that I like to serve. You know, before you're aware that it's happening, and it's just showing up in other ways. So personally for me, I was filling myself with a lot of wine. I was drinking, you know, half a bottle to a bottle of wine a night, you know, just numbing myself, filling myself with food, filling myself with online shopping, filling myself with girlfriends, filling myself with other things to try and just turn a blind eye to it, you know, and that's part of our nature is to do that, right? It's just easier to do that than it is to actually deal with the pain and look at it head on.
Yep.
And also there were, you know, in his deliveries to me, there was always this chipping away away at my soul, chipping away at my spirit, chipping away at my self-confidence, chipping away at me as a woman. And it was just that's his MO. I'm not blaming him or anything. I was receiving it. Yeah. So I'm saying this to you out there, that pay attention to the signs in your life, because if you are not waking up every day excited about the day in front of you, there's something you need to be looking at in your life.
Yeah.
And now I'm not saying all day, every day, you got to be excited, but you got to be feeling good about your life. It's your birthright to do that.
Yep.
So some of the strategies I use now, you know, I don't know if we want to get into the science of everything about what's going on in the subconscious mind versus the conscious mind. You know, we are programmed that 70% of our thoughts are negative. They just are. We are limiting beliefs. 85% of them got anchored in us by the time we're 8 years old. We've been told the word no 7,000 times by the time we're that age. And so during those years, there are the imprint years from 0 to 8 years old, where 85% of those limiting beliefs got anchored in the subconscious mind. That's your database. That's your file. That's where everything is living. And because of what's going on in the mind, that 10% is conscious and 90% is subconscious, the subconscious is running your life. So when you're trying to make changes in your life from a conscious level and it's not working, you know, you can't lose that weight or you can't see a way out or any of those things, it's because what's happening is the programming in the subconscious mind is what's running the show for you. So what we have to be able to do is bring the subconscious up to the conscious in order to heal it and remove it and move on from it. But that does not mean that you won't have moments throughout your day, your week, your month, your year, where you have those feelings of negative emotions that try and pull you back because the scale is tipped that way. It just is. Yep. So what I do, how I do it is I became very masterful at language. And I understood this quickly about myself and then in other people, how powerfully you can start attracting things into your life, good or bad, based on the way you're communicating. It's not so much all, you know, law of attraction, you know, it's, they tell you, you know, you got to get to, you know, meditate and get to that feeling place and you got to visualize and create the vision boards and do all those things, all and affirm, obviously affirm, that's part of it. But, and you might have that practice in your life, but how are you showing up the rest of your day? Think about how many times you are thinking and speaking in a negative way about you or somebody else. And law of attraction is instantaneous. It's always on. It's never off, like law of gravity. I drop my pen, it's hit the table, right? Instantaneously. Same thing with law of attraction. So the key to creating change and being able to help this is to, number one, have that awareness. Understand that's what's going on. Okay, it's not my fault. I'm not crazy. Now I know. So then I call it the ABCs. Awareness begets change. Once you're aware of it, then you can start making changes towards it. So if you can catch it, how I do it is through a lot of three-step processes. Most of everything in my book is about three-step processes. And I live by the three-step blueprint that changed my life, which is love it, thank it, bring it. So I will say, love it, thank it, bring it to myself whenever I catch myself in that place. And that pulls me right back. And what it stands for is love it stands for love your life, no matter what the condition is, no matter where you've been, no matter what you've been through, you're on this journey and you have a life to love. There's 153,000 people that didn't wake up today, but you did. So you got to love your life and you even have to love the pain, which I know you get, Tara, you know, because it teaches you so many things. It teaches you strength, resilience, clarity about what you want versus what you don't want, you know, and all of the good gifts too. So, but find the blessing in all of that and love your life. That takes care of your past. Thank it is living gratitude and appreciation for where you are right now, your present moment, your today, no matter what the things are, the good, the big things and the little things. And most of the miracles and the things that we're grateful for are in all the little things anyway. You know, the bed that you get to sleep in, that, you know how many people in the world don't know that experience? The cup of coffee or the tea or whatever it is, you, how you start your morning, the sun shining, you know, the breeze, the clouds in the sky, the roof over your head, the food in your fridge. Literally live in gratitude and appreciation for wherever you are right now. Because when you appreciate what you have, that grants you permission from the universe to start bringing you in even more things to appreciate. It's appreciation appreciates. I learned that from Lynn Twist.
Love it.
So love it, thank it, and then bring it. Bring it is, all right, how are you showing up today? How are you bringing it? This is the power piece. This is how you create your future. This is how you determine your level of happiness, fulfillment, joy, peace, success in your today. And so how are you showing up in your health? How are you showing up in your relationships? How are you showing up with your money mindset? How are you showing up in your career, with family, just in every area of your life? How are you bringing it today? So I say, love it, thank it, bring it every day. And I say it whenever I need to, because it anchors me back into being intentional, empowered, and aligned. Mm-hmm. So that's one of my hacks. Yeah.
I love that. And I love that you simplified things into three-step processes, because sometimes it's like you hear these things sometimes and then they sound too simple, you know, but then you start to do them. And I have found genius is always simple. And when you actually start to do these simple acts of gratitude, writing it down every day and how you feel when you think about those things, it is completely life changing. And like, I love what you were saying about, I always say like with gratitude, how do you feel about the people in your life? Like, sorry, dad, I'm going to throw my dad under the bus, but my dad is not a gracious gift receiver. He usually will like insult it or like make fun of it somehow. I'm like, dad, you can't say stuff like that. That's rude. Mm. But it makes me like not want to give him gifts. Right. Because I'm like, he's not grateful for him. Like he doesn't even care. He like, literally doesn't even like what I get usually. So I don't want to give him more gifts. But if somebody else who's grateful, my kids who are like, and their face lights up when I bring something, what do I want to do? I want to give them more. And I feel like the universe works that way too, right? Like when we're grateful, the universe is like, ooh, keep giving them more. They love this stuff. They love it. They appreciate it. You know, that's how I like to think of it anyway, because that's how it's felt in my life from having that kind of practice. All right. Shifting in a little more. What else do you do in your I Have Today practice that you feel like would be beneficial for people and being able to live their best life?
Well, I would say what really turned my life around is my morning routine. Mm-hmm. My morning routine is called Nurture My Spirit, Mind, and Body, where I wake up every day and I stand up and I starfish my arms and legs out and I look up and I say, I have today to love my life. Something really good is going to happen to me today. I can feel it. Miracles, big and small. I notice them all. Yes, yes, yes. Thank you. So I literally set that intention out to the universe to love my life and be seeking miracles, big and small, all day long. And so the universe always surprises and delights me. And so it's a great way to start the day. I mean, it really gets the energy, shifts the energy right away into a great, great space. And then I always go and I do my meditation, and I will say to anybody who doesn't meditate, please start meditating. Meditation will change your life on a physical, emotional, spiritual, mental, cellular level. So many ways it affects your life in a positive way. And Deepak Chopra said, if we could get our kindergartners on meditating, we would have world peace in one generation. And I totally believe it. It's just, there's so many healing benefits to it. It really was the thing that really woke me up was meditation. So meditation.
A quick note on meditation. That's funny you said kindergartners with Deepak Chopra, because I don't know about you, but when I look back at childhood, I was meditating a lot. Like we didn't have devices or anything like that. So it was just like, go outside and sometimes by myself. Right. And I remember just like digging in a little patch of dirt and like letting this dirt fall over some clovers and just sitting there in meditation, you know? And I think for me, anyway, when I meditate, it brings me back into my child self. All the other million benefits, but that's part of it too, is it brings, for me anyway, connects me back to my child self, which is like so crucial on, P.S. I have to say, in your book, I love that you put in your title, like about smiling. What's the subtitle of your book again?
It's I Have Today, Find Your Passion, Purpose, and Smile Finally. Yeah. People are not smiling enough and not having enough fun.
Yeah.
I love that you referenced, you know, being a child. Yes, we did. First of all, we were in, you know, during those 8 years, we were really in that alpha theta state anyway, most of the time. And we would daydream and we would fantasize or, you know, make believe and pretend. Meanwhile, we now know how much of that was actually real. But we were told, oh, you know, it's just your imagination, or, you know, quit goofing off, or, you know, whatever that thing was that dimmed that light for us. But yeah, we came into this world having that capacity. And over time, it just got, you know, it just eroded for a variety of reasons. So walking meditations are great. Hey, when you're driving in the car and you're in that zone, you're meditating.
Yep.
You're meditating. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's so great. And so just to allow yourself to receive whatever's coming, because in my work, I make every effort to let every client that I'm working with or whomever I'm speaking to understand that it's not supposed to be a struggle. When you're forcing up against something, you need to step away from it, back away from it. It's supposed to be an allowance, a receiving, an attraction. You know, it flows to you. It flows for you. And so that's one of the ways. And the more you meditate, the more you're able to stay in that state or get back in that state quicker.
I agree. And I was just going to say real quick, I agree with you, because what I have found as this, like, you know, chronic overachiever growing up, that meditation trains me to let go of things. That's the biggest, yes. let it, it's like, oh, I'm thinking about that. Let it go. Oh, I'm thinking about that. Let it go. And that, to me, the forcing, kind of like your marriage and mine too, you know, it was, I'm going to force it. I'm going to make this work. I'm going to make it. It's like misery, misery, misery. And it's like, how about maybe you just let it go? Cause that could possibly be better, you know? And that's what I agree with you. Cause I just feel like that the mindset of allowing yourself to let go of things is something that I only really found through meditation. I haven't been able to get there into this. People would say, just allow things. And I'd be like, what do you mean? Like, I have to create it. I have to build it. It's not just going to pop out of nowhere. You know, that's where I was at before.
Right.
I love your input on that, because I think that you're so right. That meditation is what allows us to get out of that life has to be so hard and I have to force everything kind of mindset.
Right. Right. We're so programmed. We're just, you know, so busy doing, you know, the blessing about what's happened. There's many blessings. There's a lot of negative too, but the blessing is the entire world got to shut down. I mean, I don't know if you read anything or saw anything about how fast the planet started healing. You know, smog in LA went away and dolphins are swimming along the shoreline again. And like Mother Earth was like, thank you. Thank you. Like, and she rebooted. And that gave us a chance to do that too, to really just slow down and go within. And so many people are struggling with that because they're not used to that. They're right. So used to the go, go, go. Another reason why so many people are struggling. So, but back to the morning routine. So the starfishing my arm and affirming, meditating, always writing my journal. And the journaling is always positive. It's up. It's never a rehashing of negative stuff. I just don't go there anymore. It's not worth it. But, you know, how do I want this day to unfold? Or, you know, or and lists of gratitude, things like that. That's a place that gets me, again, you know, intentional, empowered, and aligned. That's always the objective. Yeah. Yeah. And then very, very conscious with words.
Yeah. Huge on that. That's been a work in progress for me too, of being mindful of the work that I'm choosing. And then is a workout part of your morning routine? Do you include movement or is that?
I do. Actually, thank you for adding that. I do move my body. And here's the thing. After all these years, I switched. I have a trainer now. So I used to do my move your body in the morning, but now I'm doing it mostly in the evening. So I switched that up. However, I do, if I'm not seeing the trainer, I live at the beach and I go for a morning walk. And that is such a great place to just go and meditate too. And sometimes I walk along the surf, sometimes I walk on the sidewalk, but you know, it's just, yeah, I get out and move my body. Yes, definitely.
Man, if I had access to that every day, that'd be a dream for sure. I do have like a little lake by my house and that works, but something about the rhythms of that ocean, there's something really powerful about that. So that's a lucky thing to have for sure. If anybody listening and lives by the ocean, like I'm so jelly. That's so awesome.
Yeah.
And you know, there's one other thing that I don't know if you're cool with this, but like, I also feel very intuitively guided, very divinely guided in my life, as if I'm on a magical carpet ride. And as long as I keep listening and kind of following what it's telling me to do, my life just keeps getting better and better and better. I have had people tell me, they're like, I don't have that. Like, I also have seen the vision of what I'm creating in my business. And my business is also my passion. It's like, cool, let's make this a business, but it's really just my calling. And I know a lot of people, like, they've told me, they're like, I don't have that. I don't like nothing like comes to me like that. Do you have any thoughts on that? Or do you mind just kind of sharing your experience on what that's been like on your journey? Because I'm guessing it was shut off while you were married and doing the Disney ABC, or what has that journey been like for you?
Well, let me tell you how forceful the universe can be. I mean, it's so magical. So I didn't tell you as part of my story that I'm also an inventor, that I created an award-winning kitchen product that's been featured on QVC.
Very cool.
And that was something just happened again for me. And the thing is, when what happened was, it was Easter Sunday, I was making deviled eggs to bring to a family holiday, and I had them on my serving dish, and all they needed was that finishing touch of paprika. So I went to take the container of paprika and decorate them, and too much spice shot out of the container and it ruined my dish in 1 second. Uh-huh. And I am one of those people that I love to cook. I love to bake. I love to entertain. I mean, you should have seen my kitchen before. I had every gadget known to man in the kitchen, and I just was obsessed. My sisters call me Dianal because everything has to be like perfect and neat. And so
sister thing.
When that happened, in my mind, I could instantly see the product. And I went, oh gosh, if there was just a sifting spoon with a long handle and a teeny little sifting bowl with a tapping edge that I could just put the spice in and tap it where I want, how cool would that be? So the next day I set out on a quest to find this thing, and I couldn't find it. And I was driving around about a week later, and I heard a voice. Oh, no, I'm sorry. It was that day. I was driving around that day, and a voice said to me, Diane, you need to create this. I heard it loud and clear. It wasn't just like a passing thought. So I'm highlighting that because this is what's happening to everybody. They're hearing it. They're ignoring it.
Yep.
The voice is there.
Yep.
So because I heard that, I was out to dinner with friends about a week later, and I brought it up to them. And I said, I came up with this idea for a kitchen product. Do you know anyone in that industry? And they did, made the introduction, and he became my mentor and helped me. You know, he tried to talk me out of it, but my mantra was, well, I just want to see where this goes. And literally not knowing what the flip I was doing, putting one foot in front of the other, that led to winning an innovation award at the International Houseware Show and landing me on QVC. So I always share that.
I was just sorry. I'm just working over here. So awesome.
I always tell that story when I'm out speaking, because I always want to highlight to people that you are filled with ideas. We are creators, and we came here to create, and you've got many, many, many of them to create. There's 1.1 billion searches on Google every single day that are brand new search terms. Brand new, meaning nobody ever searched them before. That means there's 1.1 billion new problems seeking solutions every single day. Like, we're unlimited in what we could create. So I always want to encourage and inspire people, like, get up, like, stop writing it in a notebook or thinking about it, you know, go do something about it. Okay. So I lost my train of thought why I was going there. I was doing that about the inventing, and you said, what did you ask me?
Can I interject?
Yeah.
I'm asking you about learning to listen to that voice. So I think, I mean, that
pretty. Oh, thank you. Yeah.
But I love that my immediate thought was, she actually did it. And, you know, I've heard somebody say once, like, sometimes spirit will go around and drop the idea in a lot of people's heads. It's just, who's going to actually do it? You know, but what I hear from that story the most is the confidence that you built in listening to it. You're like, hold on a second. Look what happens when I actually listen and follow through to this voice that I'm hearing. So like, for me, that's been that way too. Is like, all you need to do, if you really want to become like intuitive, is just actually follow through on something that it's telling you to do, this, like, these feelings, these ideas, and watch the freaking magic happen. And then you start trusting it and doing it more, and it just keeps happening and happening and happening. And all of a sudden you're like, wow, I'm kind of like an intuitive spiritual person.
Yeah. And because we all are. And so back to what you were saying, like, when people are saying to you, I don't have that, it's only because they're thinking it's something outside of them. Mm-hmm. They're thinking it has to be like this big, huge thing, like you're going to save the whales or, you know, stop human trafficking, which I know there are plenty of people out there, you know, working on it. Your purpose and your reason for being here, in my definition, is whatever brings meaning to your life. Whatever brings meaning to your life. If you are a rock star mom and you love doing that, then figure out something. It's got to be something that brings meaning to your life and you feel passion over doing it. Like if I wasn't doing what I'm doing, well, 2 points. The experience of creating this spifter and feeling the fear in doing it anyway. I wasn't confident through that at all, let me tell you. And I made plenty of blunders and mistakes. That's how we learn. But the muscle and the resilience it taught me gave me the strength to leave my life in Chicago, completely reinvent it, walk away from everything I knew, quit my job, sell my house, sell everything in it, and move cross country. I got that strength because of that experience. So, and if I wasn't doing this, which I love so much, there's at least a half a dozen other things that I would love to do. I would love to be a professional decorator. I would love to be a chef. Like there's so many other things that I would love to do. So if you don't know what that thing is, ask yourself what you're passionate about. One of my processes is to create your passion pie. Write all the things that you're passionate about in your life. Just write them all down on a piece of paper and then take another piece of paper with a circle in it. And however many things you wrote down on that sheet, make that many lines in the pie. This is your passion pie. And then write all those things in and then color in the ones that you're doing and living. And don't color in the ones that you don't. And see how much you're living with passion and purpose in your life. That's an indicator. So that's a great way for somebody to figure out, oh my God, because whatever you do, there's literally no limits on the ways that you can make money. And when I say make money, I mean being in service to others. How we overlook the things that come easy and effortlessly and naturally to us. We don't give them any value. Because we think, doesn't everybody feel this way? And the truth is no, people will pay you plenty for that expertise because they don't have it.
Yep.
I have my CFO and accountant because I'm not a numbers girl anymore. Exactly. Used to be, but I'm not anymore. Like, keep me away from it. So that I can do what I do best, which is, you know, being in front of a mic, being on a TV show, being in a podcast, you know, speaking. And that's what brings meaning to my life, serving that way. So don't discount all of those little things. There's plenty of things that you are so good at that you could really, you know, really dig deeper into and create something from.
Yeah. Since you like decorating, I'll follow that up with something that I like to say, and it's Marie Kondo your mind. So yes. Does it bring you joy? With every like thing that you're doing through the day, the thoughts that you're having, the people you're associating with, like start honing in on the ones that bring you joy and start letting go of more than ones. It's like, send them to the thrift store. Like that doesn't belong in my life. It doesn't bring me any joy. Why am I taking my one life of awesomeness that I have here in this existence, no matter what you believe religiously, like this is your one go at the current human that you are. So, well, I guess that's debatable because I feel like I've lived a lot of lives inside of one life. But you know what I'm saying is like, take this journey and spin it on things that bring you joy. And that's what I'm hearing from you is like, you technically had it all. You had everything that everybody aspires to, the house, the family, the job, and it wasn't bringing you any joy. So you said, I gotta go, you know, and that's such a beautiful example. Thank you for setting that example, excuse me, for women. It's something that also lit a fire under me during my journey is I'm like, I have to show that this is possible, that you can leave it all behind and that you can go after what you want to in life and you can actually make it and be successful and be happy, you know? And I'm sure that probably brought you some fire too, is like showing like we can do this, because I think, you know, men too, but so many women can relate to your story like suppressing it all. I'm fine. I have to live like this is the only option I have. And we're both here to tell you, no, it's not. it's infinite possibilities. So do what brings you joy. If you want to find your book, is Amazon the best place? I'll link this all in the show notes, by the way, you guys, on YouTube and in all podcast platforms. But
Amazon is the best place. Yep.
Okay.
I have today, Find Your Passion, Purpose, and Smile Finally. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Diane. And then your website. Yeah. Sharing where else you would like them to come find you and partake.
Oh, yes. Oh, okay. All right, good. So my website is dianeforster.com. So DianeForster. And then you can also follow me on social media at Diane Forster Official. Subscribe to my YouTube channel and my podcast, both called I Have Today with Diane Forster. And you'll get tons of information about me.
Awesome. Thank you so much, guys. I'll put all of those links in the show notes. You can find them easily. And again, Diane, thank you just so much for taking time out of your busy schedule to come and share your heart and your soul with us today.
Well, it's my pleasure, Tara. And let me say, you're a light in this world. And I'm so grateful to be on this journey with you and that we connected. And I watch you and I follow you and I feel your energy and I feel your love and passion too. So thank you for the privilege of allowing me to be here and spend time with you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.